This way, let me begin. We are behind schedule. I have material here for probably 3-4 hours, so don't be afraid. I will be able probably to skip material on the fly. I've seen here some posters. I know you are familiar, most of you are familiar with the state estimation, so I will try to get you actively participating somewhat. In case you are familiar with the topic, I will skip. Because I don't mind I don't mind if I don't cover everything. Yes, I prefer that you be active, to be entertained. So probably rather than looking at your screen, probably you may close the laptops and looking at me or this screen, which is large enough for following the presentation. Please make questions on the fly, like yesterday during the panel session, not at the end. Make questions on the fly. It's preferable. Otherwise, you will die of boredom. So it's that's my intention. So I don't know if I will achieve it. OK, I will provide a very brief review of power system estimation. Depending on your background, I will shorten. Then I will also review the new sources of information, and this is what is called big data in power systems, both at transmission and distribution levels. I will explain the architecture we are proposing in the last few years for solving this big data issue. And then a mathematical technique we developed to properly and optimally deal with the hierarchical multi-level state estimation and with other the variation of state estimation based on this factor idea. At the end, if I have time, only if I have time, it would be interesting for me to show you, in case you want to use it for your own research areas, the factor solution of nonlinear equation systems with application particularly to the equation arising in the low flow problem. So let's see. Probably I cannot reach this point, but let's see how this evolves. But please raise your hand and make me questions on the fly. Okay.
What is WLS?
Weighted lead squares. Weighted lead squares. Okay. Sorry for that. I'm so familiar with the acronym that we say. Okay, yes, good question. I mean, it's, to begin with, it's a very, very interesting question. So, okay, how many of you are familiar with the role the state estimation plays in energy management system? Raise your hand. How many of you are totally familiar with the, this is for transmission system, but basically applies also to distribution system. I'm not talking about professors, just the students. How many of you prefer to skip this slide? One, two. Oh, 2 out of 8 or 10 or something. No? Okay, so I will briefly say something. Okay, before the 60s, we only had SCADA, not EMS. This black line and this black line, this is sandwiched in between. This was added in the 70s after the major blackouts. So before that, we only had remote terminal units that showed data to the operator, and the operator, you know, decided something basically on very rudimentary low flows of network analyzer, analog computers. So after the 70s, these all blocks develop, which is state estimation is the crucial, the cornerstone of this energy management system, because it provides the state of the system, the voltages and the flows through all lines. So if there are no violation of the limits, we say the state is normal. If there is violation, this emergency state, and we have to correct something. Otherwise, there will be a blackout. If the state is normal, we perform security assessment. I mean, we run the N-1 security assessment. And the N-1 security assessment tells you whether one of the future possible states will be in emergency, which is called alert. So we have to make preventive control actions. And then if otherwise this is secure, and we can relax and perform economic control actions. So for everything of this, there is an optimal power flow with different objective functions. For instance, here, we can minimize the corrective action. Here we can minimize the cost of preventive action. Here we can reduce losses or reduce cost of energy delivery or whatever. So there are the basic building block for this is optimal power flow. But optimal power flow cannot run if you don't have the state of the system. So for this is the, and the, you have generation scheduling for the next day, for the next hours. You have a load forecasting for the next 10 minutes of half an hour. And you have the available reactive power resources. So this is basically These tools allow the operator to take decisions with that background of computation tools, computational tools. These are the inputs. I guess you are familiar because yesterday Giannakis, Professor Giannakis, devoted some time to state estimation. So we have a static data, which is the network parameters. Topology is rather static, although it may change. In transmission system, it doesn't change so much. Also, we have a statistical model for measurement. This is static also, because the error usually doesn't change. And we have dynamic information, which is the value of real-time measurement and measurement. And with this information, both static and dynamic, we estimate the state, estimate measurement. We compare measurement, estimated measurement, with real measurement, and the difference provides the residuals. And the residual, we are able to compute the covariances of the residual, and based on this information, we can put in question or reconsider the a priori model of measurement. Okay, that's basically what we are doing with the state estimation. I guess this is enough. Otherwise, please raise your hand, and I will be happy to answer or provide more details on this information. Virtual measurements are usually enforced as a quality constraint. Okay, this is what we have. we have, until recently, before the advent of synchrophasor, we had remote terminal units providing a single phase, I mean, direct sequence component, single phase voltage magnitude, power flow, and injections. And at the sub-transmission level, we usually have also current magnitude that gives rise to some numerical problems. But these measurements are asynchronous, I mean, and they are captured at very rather slow rates. So this is the situation before the advent of synchrophasor. Of course, we have also no topology, virtual measurement, null injections, pseudo measurement, which are useful in case the network is not observable. We can resort to pseudo measurements to complement or to replace missing measurement. Okay, I think this is clear. Otherwise, I can give more details. Typically, in transmission system, the redundancy is very, very large. I mean, we have typically the ratio between the number of measurements and the number of state variables is over 4. In this case, for instance, which is maybe a real case, the ratio is 4.5, basically. We have power flows at both edge terminals of the line, power injections, voltage magnitude at any electrical bus. So this is, in transmission system, we have enough redundancy. However, in distribution system, the situation is quite different. Medium voltage and low voltage system, as you know, are radial, and there is no, so far, until recently, we didn't have anything here. We basically only have the current measurement at the head of the feeder, at the beginning of the feeder. This is a distribution substation, real distribution substation. And we have also the bus voltages of the bus bar section at the substation, this distribution substation. So with this information, it is impossible to estimate the feeders. I mean, the feeders are unobservable. We cannot know anything about the feeders. So far, there has been a vast literature about what they call load allocation, something related to based on monthly energy consumption or based on load pattern, typical load pattern, residential, industrial, so far, services, we can basically prorate the load we are observing here, we can prorate among the buses. Basically, this is what load allocation means, in few words. Okay, so this is what we have been able to do so far.
So until now, just that probability, so we see the load and we have a probability based on how to say that that's probably this type of load.
I don't understand properly. So we know this low voltage transformer, they are feeding typically residential areas.
Yeah. So we assume that when the load, because we know that it's residential, we assume that it's...
Yeah. We have, you can make offline studies and you have a clear idea of how is the shape of the load curve, how this evolves for labor days or weekends. And then you have, and you know this, and you know also the contracted power, I mean the rated power of each transformer. So you can somewhat prorate the total load, which is observed from the substation. Among this is very crude approximation, so this is not desirable. So we are moving from here to what is already happening in transmission. We are adding now a smart meter, which is, so we will see later. Now this is what we had until, let's say, 5 to 10 years ago. Well, these are the major blocks. We have the conventional estimation. We have remote terminal unit measurement. We have the topology and the parameter that we assume they are correct. The topology is correct and the parameters are perfect, which is not the case, actually. And we assume that the measurement carry only Gaussian measurement, Gaussian errors. Based on this, we perform topology processing, which reduces the network. We consider whether the network is observable or not, and we perform a state estimation, and a posteriori, we reconsider whether the assumption about the errors were correct or there are not outliers. And there are outliers which are called bad data. We try to remove them, to identify and remove the bad data. Okay, this is what we are doing. In transmission systems, where we have, you can see, very high redundancy level, over 4, we are able, actually, there's also vast literature about the inclusion of topology and parameters in the model, which is called generalized state estimation. We have contributed some papers about generalized state estimation, but I don't have time here to deal with this, so sorry for that. Okay, this is basically what we do with the topology processing. We obtain from the physical world, we have physical nodes and physical components like circuit breaker, which are open or closed. We obtain the electrical model, the electrical reduced model, which is there are three electrical nodes, even though there are maybe 10 physical or 12 physical nodes. There are only 3 electrical nodes because this is closed, this is closed, this is closed, this is open, so this is removed from the system because this is dead, open. There are only 3 measurements because this injection and the other one are collapsed in a single measurement, both of them, because this is the net injection, which is the sum of this and that. There is a power flow here, which is this one. This power flow here, this one, and this one has to be is lost. When you reduce the model, sometimes you lost measurement. You cannot handle this measurement because this is zero impedance. This is a closed circuit breaker that you cannot handle this measurement. When you use the conventional bus branch model, for this reason, we are the generalized estimator works with the expanded physical model because this way you can model individually each circuit breaker or each switch. Okay, this is topology processor. Now the mathematical model is, I guess most of you are familiar with it. We have the state vector, which in power system is always voltages, complex voltages, phasors. Measurement vector, which is voltage, passive power, reactive power, probably currents. And there is a nonlinear model relating measurement vector with the state vector, plus the residual. If there is no error, consider that if there is no error, this is an overdetermined system. There are more equations than unknowns. But we add errors, and we have x and epsilon components. So this is an undetermined system. So there are infinite solutions depending on how we choose epsilon. Which of the many infinite solutions we choose? Which is which x is? Okay, we can minimize several norms of epsilon, for instance, which is the error, the residual. Okay, this is typically what we assume when we run state estimation. We assume that the errors are Gaussian distributed, they are independent and correlated, they are unbiased, and there is a standard deviation, and the covariance of each error is there is a diagonal matrix, there's uncorrelated, there's a diagonal matrix, which is called the covariance of the error. This is typically the assumption, but of course, the measurement set contains outliers, and then this doesn't hold. According to statisticians, given those hypotheses, the maximum likelihood estimator is the one called weighted least squares. I mean, we minimize this scalar, which is the sum of the square of the residual with a weighting factor, which is the inverse of the covariance. Basically, this is, according to mathematicians, this is the maximum likelihood estimator, the one which maximizes the probability that the estimated state is the correct one. We will never know the correct one. We just try to approach the correct one. This is called the residual. So we are minimizing the sum of the squares of the residual times a weighting coefficient. Are you familiar with other norms, other objective functions, for instance? Which one? which other function? Students. Would you be able to contribute to other objective function, which is not a square? Okay. Yeah. So what, in few words, we are minimizing the two norm. And you say we can minimize the one norm, which is the least absolute value, or weighted least absolute value. This is weighted least squares. Okay. Sorry? Yeah, another norm. And then also, why not? The zero norm. This is the number of non-zero in the residual. Okay. The question is, weighted least squares is statistically optimal for Gaussian errors, but it's not robust. A single bad data, which is very large, can totally destroy the estimate. So it's not robust against a single bad data. On the contrary, weighted least absolute value is more robust. So you know that weighted absolute value leads to a linear programming problem, and in the linear programming problem, you have some constraints. And do you converge, the minimum of the linear programming is one vertex. In the vertex, n measurement out of f of n measurements are exactly satisfied in the vertex. And the other n minus n are totally discarded. So this estimator doesn't filter. The only thing is that select a subset of measurement which minimize the norm. But the remaining measurements are not used. So this is, there are trade-offs. There are advantages and disadvantages between weighted least square and weighted least absolute values. And there are other robust estimator. There is a well-known paper by Huber. Other estimator, non-quadratic estimator, which use basically variable weights. Weights which are not constant, but weights which are smaller. The larger the residual, the smaller the weight. They are non-quadratic function. Instead of being a quadratic function of the residual, this is the residual, this is the square, there is something like this, non-square. So larger residual are down-weighted in the objective function. Okay? So this is basically another non-robust. We belong to these categories, or other categories, more sophisticated objective function. Okay? For this particular problem, you must assume that most measurement should be basically Gaussian. Otherwise, you can also assume uniform distribution, but then there is another kind of objective function for uniform distribution, which is not this one. So, but a majority of measurements should be, if they are properly tuned and calibrated, they should be Gaussian. I mean, otherwise you are lost. I mean, you should consider totally the problem. Okay, so this is the weighted least squares. See?
Experimentally, which is, you have probably some experiments, some data. So which is the distribution usually in reality of the error? Because we approach it as a Gaussian, but is it actually in reality closer to Gaussian?
Yeah, it's somewhat between what Gaussian and uniform, probably more Gaussian than uniform. But there is no, actually this is something that's practical issue which has not been very thoroughly studied, to be frank. I mean, somebody should do this effort, but utilities probably don't have the resources or the necessity of checking. Actually, the major problem, to be frank, is that most state estimators running currently in all control centers, they are using, I mean, foolish weighting factors. They are not tuning. They don't know what is the error. I mean, they guess. Okay, this is instrumentation transformer, current and voltage transformers. They are class A, class B, or whatever. They're 0.5% or 1%. And based on this, they basically try to obtain value for the covariance of the errors. But this is not properly tuned. Some estimator only use the same weighting coefficient for all power flow measurement, for instance, which is totally incorrect. So this is more basic problem. But you are raising a very important practical problem which requires tuning. And this is seldom done, unfortunately. I mean, it's done, but not very carefully, or carefully enough. OK. So this minimization, of the objective function, the optimality condition is we have to find the zero, the solution of this nonlinear system, where this is the Jacobian, and this leads to the Gauss-Newton. You know, Gauss-Newton is not exactly Newton, Newton-Raphson. It's an approximation because we are neglecting second-order terms, which are usually small, not always. I don't have time to go into the detail. A statistician called this the normal equation, and this is usually called gain matrix, but in information theory, it's also called the information matrix, not only the gain matrix. No? Okay, the symmetrical, the positive definite matrix when the network is observable, fully observable. Okay, the solution process is we compute simultaneously the Jacobian on the right-hand side and the gain matrix simultaneously. And then perform Cholesky factorization of the gain matrix and obtain del X by forward and backward elimination. And this is very easily done in MATLAB with the sparse packages they have. So until we converge. Okay, this is the geometrical interpretation. It's, we are obtaining a point, well, actually this is not nonlinear, it should be linear. Not h of x, but h times x, linear. With the linear version, this is, we are minimizing the distance between h, x, and z. So we are trying to reduce this length. Okay, so this is perpendicular, the residual is perpendicular to the Jacobian columns. Okay, as I said, the Wetterit square estimator is non-robust. But we can, a posteriori, try to correct this problem. If there is a single bad data, it is, can be easily identified by computing the normalized residual. This is tricky computationally. I don't have time to explain how, but we can compute the diagonal of the covariant of the residual. Note that there is an inverse here. This is tricky. I don't have time to explain, but if you are interested, at the end, I can go back. So we compute the diagonal of the covariance matrix of the residual and then normalize the residual. So all of them are normal 0, 1, so they can be compared. All of them can be compared. So we can rank the residuals and perform this algorithm, which is identify the largest normalized residual and remove this measurement. Why we remove only one? Because there is a smearing process. So there may be four or five large residuals with a single bad data, because a single bad data may spread, I mean, to several adjacent measurements. So we have to remove only the largest one, repeat the estimation without that measurement, and then see if there are remaining large residual, normalized residual. Okay? Just briefly, because I don't have to stop here. This is a revision still. Computational issues are also very important for solving very large-scale systems. This is the Jacobian of the 118-band system. There are many rows. The redundancy is nearly three, right? Nearly three. This is the columns. And the row, the number of measurements. This, for instance, the derivative of voltage with respect to voltage is one in the diagonal and zero in Z. And every power flow has four non-zero elements, two with B and two with theta. And with injection, depend on the sparsity, on the number of incident branches. Okay. So this is the gain matrix, which is symmetric, positive definite if the network is observable, so you can safely perform Cholesky factorization. Or as the conditioning of this system usually is bad because of the heterogeneous weighting coefficient and other reasons which are you can resort to the literature. Usually, sometimes proposed to use QR factorization of H instead of LU factorization of G. This is numerically much more robust, but computationally more expensive. Okay. Okay. This is. To begin the review, probably longer than I expected, but I don't mind. I want you to make questions rather than covering the entire material. It's more important that you be active and not sleeping and trying to participate, like in the panel session yesterday. Okay, what's happening? What's going on in the new paradigm of the smart grid paradigm? We are having a boom of information, both at the transmission and distribution system, as I will try to argue. In transmission system, we have the so-called intelligent electronic devices, which are basically digital protective relays. Digital protective relay, for some reason, they call intelligent electronic devices. So before the smart grid advent, we already use intelligent. So it's, the word is old. This was developed by Fatke et al., those Thorpe, and these are the same group, Virginia Tech, the same group that later on developed the synchrophasors, okay? So these were the pioneers of this idea of using moving this DFT, discrete Fourier transform, to process waveforms, to process what they did, what these relays do. They sample voltages and currents. They obtain, let's say, many samples of voltage and current, and perform by DFT, obtain harmonic, the fundamental harmonic of the fifth harmonic, for instance, in case of the transformer differential relay, they need the fifth harmonic or the like. So they compute the fundamental harmonic and any harmonic they want, and they perform their duty, their protective function, based on this information. So for this information, they don't need to be synchronized with other devices. Just they have to their own waveforms, okay? So these digital relays, there are many of them. This is an example of the Cell. Cell was the first company that introduced in the commercial catalog a digital relay in 1984. And this was probably, in my opinion, the milestone marking the beginning of the smart grid era, in my opinion. Because this, I mean, digital technology came earlier in the 70s with the computers in the control center. But in the substation, in the physical world, not in the control room, the first time that digital technology was introduced was at this time, when they sold this kind of relays that now are very common. In fact, all transmission substations are digital now. A new distribution substation, they try to also introduce digital relays. So, okay. These devices, since they are digital, they are communicating with the external world. They can communicate and submit and send what they are measuring. They are measuring electrical magnitude for the protection purposes, but they can also use this information and send it to the external world. It can be used for other purposes, not only for protection, but for measuring. This is another example of a company, a Spanish company, ZIV, which is the Basque Country company. This is another example. You can see that you measure all voltages, currents, active power, reactive power, power factor, frequency, negative component, zero component, everything. So this relay provides you everything. And everything can be sent to the external world and can be collected outside. And this was not possible with the analog relays. And this makes a big difference in nowadays substation compared to the older ones. Okay, then we also have much later the same group, Fathke and Thoth, the same group much later introduced the concept of phasor measurement unit, which in my opinion is not so important as digital relay, because phasor measurement units is simply the same but with the GPS signal. The GPS signal allows you to synchronize. So this is the waveform in a substation E, and this is the waveform in a substation B. So the GPS signal, there is a digital relay here, IED, dealing with this signal, and another IED handling this signal. Before the advent of synchrophasor, those two signals were not synchronized. I mean, substation E was watching this signal, substation B was this. Thanks to the GPS, we gave a common reference. With the GPS signal, we were able to synchronize the waveform from one substation with respect to the nearby substation or with respect to very distant substation. So we can now compute phase angles that were not possible. Before that, we only computed phase angle between voltage and current, which is the power factor, but not phase angle between one voltage and a remote voltage. So the main contribution of PMUs with respect to IEDs is only this time stamp. That's one. That's the only thing. And this provides phase angles. Okay? Any question? Giannaki yesterday talked a lot about this. I saw the slide, so I don't want to stop here. Actually, this is what Red Eléctrica, for instance, is doing. Red Eléctrica already had IEDs everywhere in all Spanish transmission, substation transmission. Everywhere. And now, in the last few years, they are slowly adding PMUs to those relays, which is very cheap. They have this relay, and this relay has an input for GPS signal. That's all. Of course, they prefer to invest probably in new devices and keep them. Sometimes they add new devices in rather than adding GPS. But new relays already come with PMU synchronization, GPS synchronization. So they are called PMUs while they are just relays. And the main purpose of using PMUs is not for state estimation, it's for relaying. Okay, other events, transient events, and this kind of other purposes rather than state estimation. Okay, I will not stop here. This is a communication issue. Well, you know that there is a data concentrator which must be introduced between the PMU and the SCADA. There are so many PMUs, and they are able to capture information at a very fast rate. So there should be some buffer in between, which is the phasor data concentrator, PDC, phasor data concentrator. Okay, I don't want to stop here. This is important. There is a standard, 61850 architecture for substation. How many of you students are familiar with this? One, two. So would you please explain the two buses, or would you be able to briefly explain the structure of this architecture, or just two buses, the process bus and the station bus? Would you like to do that?
Sure.
So be aware, I will be asking you from time to time, so don't sleep. Would you be able to explain basically the purpose of the process bus?
I'm mostly focused on the communication requirements of the standard, so the development
communication. Okay. Okay, as far as we are interested in is the process bus is the interface with the physical world. This is the analog world. This is the switch gear, the switch circuit breaker, the current transformer, voltage transformer. This is the analog world, the physical world, which is always analog. Well, this is analog, and switch gear state is digital, on, off. And this process bus is, it's time critical service. It has to interface without interruption those physical devices with the relays. So the relays are critical. They cannot stop. They cannot be an interruption. So this communication should be instantly and continuously done. So there's no possibility of interruption here, because the protections should be always monitoring electrical magnitudes. So the process bus is critical. And this is basically the interface between the analog and the digital world, basically, with these GUs, messages, and the like. And there's a specific part of the norm, of the standard. And then we have the station bus. The station bus is something different. It's a chain peer P2P messages, and this communicate EIED with the nervous. All IID can be communicated with each other. The information can be remotely submitted through a gateway, and the information can be also, and this is important, very important, locally processed by the local computer. This is the important thing. Most substations, transmission substations, I think all of them, have already a computing capability. So they can locally process all this information. Beware, there's a lot of information here. Maybe 50 relays or in a small substation, and each relay can capture a lot of magnitudes and at a quite quick rate. So there's a lot of information that could be processed here. So this gives you the opportunity to either continually sending the information to the remote control center through the proprietary probably communication channel, like it's currently done by remote terminal units, or we can, in addition, or as a substitution, we can process locally all this information and then send previously processed information to the control center, a subset of information. So this architecture gives very easily rise to a substation management system, which is a notion we have been promoting in the last few years and successfully so far. Okay, this is substation management system should be in charge of processing locally the raw information. Please, sorry, there's another one behind.
From communications point of view, I would like to know which is approximately the physical distance between IEDs in different substation lines to enable this peer-to-peer communication. The physical distance?
It depends on the substation. I know the transmission substation may be huge.
No, distribution level.
For distribution level, you know the distance inside the substation, the land occupied by the substation?
For inter-substation communication.
Actually, there is in distribution system, as far as I know, the distribution substation, they communicate to a central point rather than point to point.
Yeah, sure, but current standardization efforts provision this kind of communication.
Yeah.
This 61850
tries
to be.
Yeah, this is expensive to communicate between substation and, yeah. The distance between substation, it depends. It depends, maybe 2-5 kilometers, this kind of thing. 1-5 kilometers, they are around the cities, you know. And usually, this is a transmission substation, not only, I mean, there are 50 kV or 66 kV lines arriving to the substation, okay. Well, this is basically a nice picture diagram of Alstom that I like to use, because we can see here the process bus communicates or links the physical world, the sweep breaker and the physical world with the relays. These are the cabinet of the relays. So this is the process bus, the analog world and the digital world. And then we have behind, in the back office, so to say, the station bus that allows all those devices to communicate with each other, also with the control local control room, or also to the way to inter-substation link, to another substation or to the control center. Sorry, I forgot you.
Yeah, no so, which is each bay, the, how many customers could you have per substation normally?
This is a diversity. Yeah. Typically, this is a real substation. Let me show you. This is a real substation. Typically, this is a, I don't know, it's in red. Typically, there are between, let's say, 10 to 20 lines, feeders, medium voltage feeders, 10 to 20, 25 medium voltage feeders. Or in rural areas, there are maybe less than 10, let's say 5 feeders, something like this. Each feeder may feed between 10 to 40 and 50 secondary transformers, medium voltage, low voltage transformers. And each transformer typically ranges between 400 kilowatts and one megawatt, I mean, each transformer. So, you know, if we are residential customer, 4 kilowatts each, so simultaneity coefficient, the light, you can have an idea of how many customers you have. I can give you some figure now. Sorry, you are also?
So it's possible to process locally with the information, providing also estimation or data analysis services?
Yeah, this is what we have published quite several papers about the estimation on this environment.
We could assume it as a local center in a multi-area scenario, exchanging directly.
This can be done. Actually, this is what I'm going to suggest later, the hierarchical structure. Okay, what this implies? What does this imply? This is the old traditional RTU-based substation. We only have single-phase P&Q. We have instrumentation transformer just for measuring. We have devoted instrumentation transformer just for measuring this. In addition to the instrumentation transformer for protection, we have usually more accurate instrumentation transformer for measuring, for RTUs. So in the substation, in the old substation, we have instrumentation transformer for measuring, RTUs, but there are very few, and many instrumentation transformers for protection, which are usually less accurate because, you know, protection doesn't need so much accuracy for measuring quantities, electrical quantities. So we have, let's say, P and Q at every line, P and Q and voltage at the two electrical buses, very few measurements. So traditional state estimation only use this information, single phase information. So we are moving from this to an environment in which each instrumentation transformer is read by the digital relay. And this digital relay can send this information, this electrical quantity, voltage, current, power factor, whatever, can send to the external world. So the information available now in the digital world is about an order of magnitude larger than we had in the old substation, analog substation, equipped only with RTUs. And these are three phase, and we have PMU, they are synchronized, and they incorporate phase angles. Otherwise, they don't have phase angles. Only many measurements. Okay, smart meters. I think I will skip this. You are probably more expert than me in smart meters. Just raising your, I mean, calling your attention on the fact that this can be used, smart meters can be used not only for energy metering, which is what they are used for now. In my opinion, they should be used. They should be used. So the regulation should force utilities to use the information provided by the smart meter also to improve, to enhance the operation of distribution systems and the observability of distribution systems. But for this purpose, they should be scanned at a much higher rate than for energy measurement. For energy measurement, in Spain, for instance, measuring every hour is enough. Or even in the old times, once a month. But for operation of the distribution system, they should be scanned every, I don't know, 10 minutes, every minute, every 10 seconds. This is ideally what we should do.
There's a topic about that, like you can have the smart meter scan on its own every even 1 minute, but just save the data every 1 hour, but you have it take data for 1 hour.
Yeah, this is what they do. Actually, the smart meter has the capability to capture. They have a buffer, a huge buffer, and they can store measurement for several hours. But and then can be downloaded offline to somewhere. But this is not for practical real-time operation, this is not valuable. You must receive, let's say, every minute, every half a minute, this information to be able to track the evolution of the distribution system much in the same way as they have been doing for the last 40 years in transmission systems. So what we are doing in transmission system with RTUs can be done in distribution system with smart meter, provided the smart meter are communicated with a PLC with enough bandwidth, which is not the case, unfortunately.
Just a question about the use of the smart meter. Is it just a meter for you, or should it, so instead of just communicating what it measures, should it also be used as a way to transmit control information, so make some information available to the customer that will
yeah.
make control possible?
Yeah. No, this is another role. You're talking about another role of a smart meter, not only for the operator of this distribution management system to be aware of the situation of the network, but also for the customer vice versa. By bidirectional information, the customer may receive prices of energy or some other I don't know, the energy he consumed the last hour or something. So yeah, it can be bidirectional. But for the purpose of state estimation, I am interested in the direction bottom up. Okay. Yeah, the power factor. Power factor. The angle between voltage and current. Because this is for industrial, this is may affect the billing. If your power factor is close to one, you will only pay after power. If your power factor is below a level, you are also paying a penalty. Okay. Okay, so I will skip. In the same way as we have phasor data concentrator, we have also smart grid, smart meter concentrator. So typically they put a smart meter concentrator at every transformer, secondary transformer. So this can be, and then use PLC from home to the secondary transformer, and then the smart meter grid concentrator can send a public network or whatever. You are more expert than me, so I don't dare to continue talking about communication in this context. So you know better than me. Something that I yesterday mentioned in the panel session is the importance of in the future of distribution automation. For me, a real smart grid is the one which is capable of detecting faults very quickly, isolating the fault. The part of the network which is, I mean, cannot work anymore until they are repaired. And then reconfiguring automatically the network so that all affected customers can be fed, you know, there are alternative paths. You know, these are the distribution system are gradually operated, but they are structurally meshed. There are loops. There can be different sources of different paths. So if there is a faulty portion, you can be fed through the other path, right? So distribution automation is a notion, it's a very old notion. It was in the 70s in the environment. I mean, I started to read distribution automation paper, I mean, many years ago, but the technology was very expensive. I mean, there are so many feeders, so many customers, that it's impossible to invest in distribution automation. It was impossible. Now that the communication are much cheaper and more reliable, the society is asking distribution companies for more reliability, less interruption rate, less duration of interruption or whatever. So they are now, this picture, I took this picture. You go to the country and then you can see this kind of circuit breaker or recloser on the pole, hanging from the pole with an antenna. So this means that before that, a person had to drive and then walk probably some meters to the pole and then manually open the switch. And then with the phone, okay, I've opened the switch. What's the next thing I have to do? Okay, travel to 2 kilometers away and then close the other one. There were usually several things in parallel, working in parallel with the telephone. So this no longer is necessary if you have a circuit breaker which can be remotely operated. This is basically the heart of the distribution automation. You know what? You already have the communication channel for sending tripping signals. So you have the channel, and you have a current transformer here because you have to open and there are faults, so you have to detect the overcurrent. So you have everything. So why not using this channel also, which is probably lazy, also for sending the measurement to the control center? So the fault locator or the recloser can also act as a distributed remote terminal unit in between, just in the country, everywhere. So this is another source of information in distribution system. Yeah, I mean,
in what you said, it sounded like it's the smart meter that is figuring out where the fault is.
No, probably I didn't explain.
The central control of that calculates where the fault is as well.
Sorry, I didn't explain. I didn't make myself properly. So, no, what I'm trying to say is that both smart meters and distribution automation devices, both of them, they are communicating nowadays. Probably not at the sufficient rate. But they are communicating, so they are providing new information that was not available earlier. And this information can be used not only in case of fault, but also for regularly operating, for minimizing losses, for instance. So you can use this information for the regular operation, for controlling the voltage, checking the voltages, whether the voltage is very low or very high. This wasn't very important in the old days of passive distribution feeders. But now you have distributed generation, and the voltage may raise with the photovoltaic very, very high, and it's very dangerous. And there is no way to check unless you have a measurement, or you can perform the computation with an electrical model. So this information will be helpful in the new context of active feeders with electrical vehicle, distributed generation, energy storage, etc., to be able to know what's going on in the network. So, but probably I didn't explain properly the purpose of the smart meter. I don't know if this is what you...
No, it's clear enough. It was just...
Okay. So this is a sectionalizing point, which is very common. Usually, there are several radial feeders converged to the single point where they can be switched. This point is a place where a radial feeder comes here, another radial feeder comes here, another radial feeder comes here, from other substation, another feeder, from other substation, one, two, three, five feeders. In this case, five feeders arrive to a single point. Typically, these are inside a building in the urban areas, but in rural areas there are poles like this. So you can see probably four, one, two, three, four, because this is a ring configuration. These are not here, not single bus, but ring configuration. So this is common. I mean, this is what happened in the rural areas. This is an example. This is a device by Siemens, which is Simprotec. This device can be used both as fault locator, but also as RTU, elemental RTU, providing BIPQ power factor. Okay, so this information, you remember we have this is not observable. This is the distribution system so far was a black box. We didn't have an idea of what were going on in the distribution system. So we have only information at the head of the feeders. And with this information, we may be able to estimate the electrical voltage of all electrical buses in the radial feeders. So we may use AMI, I mean advanced metering infrastructure, a metering reading, to, so to say, illuminate or observe, estimate the state of the distribution system. And this is one of the main actors in the mapping paradigm. So the information increases by, may increase up to 3 orders of magnitude, depending on the number of customers. I'll give you some example. This is a real system feeding an area with about nearly 2 million people. So the transmission system behind this figure is feeding nearly 2 million people, okay? And this comprises about 40 sub-transmission substations or distribution substations, so to say, more properly speaking. These 40 substations. Okay, we have about 10, 12 measurements per substation. So overall, in the old days of RTUs, we have about 500 measurements. If those measurements were transmitted, let's say, every 10 seconds to the distribution management system, we will have a 50 measurements per second in average, which is basically the bandwidth, 50 measurements per second, very low. This is what we had in the old days, basically, approximately, to be collected at the DMS. Now, this 2,000 million people is feeding about 500,000 customers, typically, maybe. In average. So if we scan the smart meters of those customers every 15 minutes, okay, we have only 555 measurements per second. But 15 minutes probably is not enough for taking the operation of the network. If we increase the rate to 1 minute and we capture those measurements every minute, we have 10,000 measurements per second, which is much more than 50 measurements per second that we have nowadays. So this gives you an idea of we increasing 2 or 3 orders of magnitude the information we must collect if we pretend to continue the current paradigm of receiving everything at the control center.
So we have here about 40 substations?
Yeah, some of them are larger. This is a very large substation, for instance. This is a small one. This is a rather small. This is feeding railway stations. This is medium size. This is a small one. Rural. This is a rural substation. I mean, I know most of them,
okay,
personally.
So it's more or less about 10,000 to 20,000 customers per small
substation. In this case, yeah. But this may change.
So
may change.
If we gather information on each substation and we cluster that information, we can say instead of that have 10,000 meters, I have 5 meters. All five of them at this time, load, mm-hmm. All the others at this time.
Yeah.